Blitz is defined as a sudden savage attack. It is indeed all this. The effect is sure. The premise is simple. It's a basic primal confrontation, man to man. No excuses are offered. None accepted.
Welcome to the latest edition of Longhorn Blitz with horns247.com.
Looks like a radio station.
Now, here are your hosts, lifetime Longhorn Rod Babers.
Pure athlete, yeah.
A transcend race, hombre.
Matt Butler.
I don't talk, man. I back it up.
And we are chock full of that, man.
Damn right.
And Jeff Howe.
It's still real to me, damn it.
And that's the bottom line, because Stone Cold said so.
If you're going to blitz, come strong, but don't come at all.
Just when I think we don't have stuff to talk about on the show. We've got signees getting arrested and injuries and all kinds of fun stuff happening. Bill Belichick coming to the 40 acres.
Belichick, baby.
We'll get into that. Buddy. All kinds of stuff happening. And we got one of our favorite, actually, he is our favorite guest that we have on Longhorn Blitz.
True that.
No disrespect to Earl Thomas or True Jamal that. Charles or Mark Henry.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You said it. Yeah, that's why I say I brought up Mark Henry.
But see, I don't agree with that, Mark. You guys know how it is.
I agree with that, Mark.
When we have Mark in, I got to face Mark, and I got to face the music for that comment. Mm-hmm. So that's on me.
He ain't gonna like that.
If I get the world's strongest slam here in the studio, I deserve it.
You know it.
Anyway, we'll get to all that here. Just a little bit on this latest edition of Longhorn Blitz with horns247.com. I am Jeff Howe. Let me bring in the rest of the team. The master of the soundboard, the drop machine extraordinaire, the man behind the glass, Matt Butler. Pushing the dials on this one. What's
yeah,
up?
Yeah, sure. Same old, same old. Another day in the nice city of Austin, Texas.
Absolutely. Yeah, the third member of our team, our lockdown corner on the show, lifetime Longhorn 2002 UT All-America 2002 semifinalist for the Jim Thorpe Award fourth round draft choice of the New York Giants in 2003. Spent his NFL career with Giants, Lions, Bears, Bucks, Broncos, and a year with the Hamilton Tiger Cats of the CFL. He also had that 1 year in the Arena League that we don't ever talk about.
Wasn't a full year.
Wasn't a four-year, so not worth talking about. Just leave that off the resume. When he was done with football, got himself back to the 40 acres where he earned his degree. If he had a T-ring, he would wear it proudly. But he is a card-carrying member of DBU, number 21 in your program, number one in your hearts, Mr. Rod Babers.
What's up, brother?
Rod, everything going well?
Everything's going good, man.
It's always a good day when we have our good friend who is our guest this week on the show.
No doubt, himself
a lifetime Longhorn. 2006 UT All-American, a second-round draft choice, got you beat there, Rod, of the Denver Broncos back in 2007. Spent his NFL career with the Broncos and the Tampa Bay Bucks, now getting it done in the realm of personal training. He just had a session this morning, got another session this afternoon, so he's carving out some time for the Blitz. Lifetime Longhorn, Tim Crowder, back on the show. Tim, always good to see you, man.
Oh, man. Excited to be here. Ready to talk some football.
real quick, you had your pro guys this morning. You got your youngsters. This afternoon, how's everything going in the training world these days?
Super, super busy, but fun, man. I mean, getting all my kids, my high school is ready for spring ball. Getting the pro guys back in the swing of things. We've been going about 2.5 weeks now, so you know, those guys are starting to finally get the soreness out. So it's starting to get in the grind again.
Mm-hmm. Now, it's interesting that we've got you on today because yesterday the news came out that one of your former teammates, Jamal Charles, being released by the Chiefs, and I heard, whether it's talk radio or ESPN, a lot of people saying he's done. He's got nothing left in the tank. You can see this is a guy that's at the end of his career. Your opinion, Tim, you know him better than any of us in this room do. What does Jamal Charles have left to offer an NFL franchise?
He has a lot to offer. You know, once he gets healthy, some guys just want to rush things back, but once he gets healthy, and you know, he's going to be the same Jamal Charles, and he's going to make some team out there very, very happy, you know, so. Now, once he gets the knee back, he's going to start coming back down here now to do his rehab. So he can get back around the Longhorn love, you know, and be ready to go whenever OTAs or whoever signs him.
Rod, you follow the pro game closer than any of us do. What do you think Jamal Charles has left in the tank?
Yeah, he and Adrian Peterson, both probably the best running backs of their era.
Yep.
Both of those guys, ironically, are going to be free agents at the same time. One of them is, I believe, Adrian Peterson is 31, and Jamal's 30, right? I believe he's 30 years old. But that is the, right, that's the cliff supposedly for running backs in the NFL. We all know the shelf life. We all know the numbers. But those guys are special, and we know that. So they are not really the guys you can throw in the average. I think both of them, and I don't know how, I'm sure they got a lot of money. I don't know how many contracts they've signed. Both of those guys have signed multiple contracts in the league, big contracts. is it? I mean, I would, if I was those guys, I'd look at, and Raiders got a really good offensive line, probably the best offensive line behind the Dallas Cowboys in the league. Yeah, I mean, I look at teams like that. I really would. They're not coming home. I don't think people are like the Cowboys and the Texans. It ain't happening. The Texans and the Cowboys are good, and this is a deep running back draft too, guys. Yeah. It's real. I mean, this is
Deontay
one of the best.
Foreman got to the combine today.
Yeah, it's one of the best running back drafts we had. I don't know, in a while.
And, yesterday, I guess.
Yeah, so that's going to be a factor too.
Right, and when you look at Jamal Charles too, if you just compare it. Now, his last season was a little bit of a drop-off when you look at before the injury, but still over 5 yards per carry, 5.1 yards per carry in that last 2015 season. You look at him overall, out of backs with at least 900 carries, he has the highest yards per carry in NFL history at 5.5.
That's
so you're
freaky.
Talking about still only, you know, being within a half a yard of the best ever. Now, we haven't seen him be healthy for two full seasons. He only had 12 carries this past year. The year before, he had 5.5 per. That's pretty impressive. So it's just all about the health, and that's one issue, though. When you depend on running and speed and you have knee issues, hopefully they are not prolonged. They are not attached. They're just something that you need to recuperate from.
Yeah.
I always like to ask you guys this because I mentioned Deontay Foreman is at the combine, the lone Longhorn at the combine for the second year in a row. Hopefully that starts to change here pretty soon. Sitting here with two guys that experience the NFL scouting combine.
Oh, man. We've heard some funny stories. I remember Tim, the last time he was in, was telling some funny stories.
Tim, go ahead. You were there.
It's a funny experience overall for everybody.
Tim, you had you were at the Megatron combine.
Front row. Ooh,
that's a freaky one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, basically, you know, it's kind of like folklore now. But, but what he basically did, I remember the coaches kept you know how it is. I didn't realize how competitive it was at the combine.
Pressure cooker, man.
Yeah, it's a pressure cooker. So he wasn't going to do anything. You know, he's going to just wait till his pro day. But the coaches kept messing with him and like, you know, you soft, you don't want to compete and all this. You know how they are.
Yeah, you're a prima donna.
No, yeah, prima donna.
You're a pretty boy. Okay, I see that. You are doing it all for the money. You ain't here. Yeah, I mean, no, trust me.
It's really like that.
It's crazy. They turned into juveniles almost, these grown men.
And so what happened is he went and borrowed, I don't know who it was, but he borrowed some, I don't know who cleats it was.
Oh, man.
He borrowed somebody cleats.
That's so awesome.
He didn't even bring cleats.
Who wears the same size shoe as him?
Well, so that's a lot of freaks at that combine. Yeah. I will say that. I mean, it's a bunch of.
So he borrowed someone's cleats and put them on and just ran a 4.35 and took his cleats right back off, gave it back to the guy, and just left. He left and went back home. We didn't see Calvin Johnson anymore.
Wow. Must be nice.
That's Deion Sanders' style. That's what Deion Sanders has a story kind of like that, right? I mean, like, I don't know, he got there or something. Nobody expected it and ran like, I don't know, 4.2 something.
Yeah, I mean.
Just, that is.
I mean, he was 6'5 and a half. He weighed 242 and ran a 4.35.
See, when you think about
and the combine, that's laser. When so you know it's way faster than that
way
on that
faster.
Time.
That's what I was just going to say. I was like, man, 4.3. That's. Dude, I ran a 4.4 flat, I believe. 4.35. That means he could probably run a 4.2. On the regular when he wants to, like really could. Because that laser time is way slower. That's man. And when you get the chance to see freaks, and it's amazing. Think about this at the combine. They're all freaks. Like these are some of the greatest athletes on the planet. I mean, they literally are, and all of them there competing, hanging out. But when you get even the guys there who have to like. Watch some of these guys who are of the X-Men. Yeah. They are the Magnetos and the, you know what I mean? They are the, you know, the Professor X. They are the Wolverines. They are the group. They are just, they are standouts. And, when you watch those guys, it's like, man, that dude is a freak.
Yeah.
I remember that.
I got the chance to train with them as far as we was all in the same combine camp. It was, you know, Adrian Peterson, Patrick Willis, Marshawn Lynch.
What?
You know, we had all those guys competing with each other, and it's funny. I would look at them, and I was just like, man, you guys. I would see Adrian Peterson. He was in there doing, like, one-arm pull-ups, you know, just like 10 out of –
like, this is like a movie.
Like 10 out of –
It's like a work – yeah,
it's like a cartoon drawing.
He was probably the most naturally strongest out of all of us. On bench press, he wasn't that good, but when it come to natural – which is basically football.
Grown man.
Mm-hmm. He killed all of us. And I just remember all of those guys. I was just like, man, you guys are freaks. Man, you freaks. they was all looking at me like,
you're free too, dude.
Like, you weigh 270 some pounds and you do the same drills we do.
That's why. So you shine at the freak show, second round. Tim had a freaky draft class,
despite the fact that Jamarcus Russell went number one overall.
He was out there too.
But he was a freak. That was a draft freak.
These were the guys in Tim's draft class: Calvin Johnson, Joe Thomas, LaRon Landry, Adrian Peterson, Patrick Willis, Marshawn Lynch,
Patrick Willis,
Darrell Revis, Lawrence Timmons, Michael Griffin, Reggie Nelson, Dwayne Bowe, Brandon Merriweather, John Beeson, Greg Olsen was in there, Paul Posluszny was in there, Eric Weddle, Sidney Rice, Lamar Woodley, Steve Smith, Ryan Khalil. So, yeah.
Khalil is still playing to this day.
Joe Thomas, too, still making Pro Bowls every single
year. Would you guys like to rehash what your combine numbers were back when you went? Because I've got them. I've got them all.
CB always sends me my
Tim, you came in at 6'3 and a half, 272, 4.69 in the 40. 10-yard split was 1.59, 20-yard split, 271. Your 20-yard short shuttle, 4.43. Three-cone drill, 7.28, 30.5-inch vertical.
I was tired by that vertical. I was worn out by that time. It should have been higher than that, but I was just like, I'm tired. I think I did enough on the speed.
I'll tell you what stands out about his 40, though, because you went over the times. The 10-yard, that's what 1.59,
10-yard.
That's fantastic. Because I don't even think I beat that by that much.
That's what I do for a living.
I was like, that's exactly what the scouts were looking at. It was like, man, it's 10-yard. They don't give a damn about the whole
Tim, you had also it went 9.3 in the broad jump, 32 reps on the bench, and a 30 on the Wonderlic test. So, congratulations. Yeah. Rod, the combine scores I have for you, there's a lot that's not filled in for whatever reason.
What's older school? I mean, the beginning of the internet
scouting era.
Exactly.
There's one crappy old site that had them all.
And I've got it, Rod, 5'9", 192. Your 40 was 4.43, 20-yard split, 2.58. Your 10-yard dash actually was better than Tim's. Tim had 1.59. You were 1.57.
Yeah, but just barely. I'm a DB.
15 reps on the bench press, 37-inch vert.
Bench press is disappointing.
4.07 shuttle, 6.83. On a three cone, and
that's quick.
It says your Wonderlic score was not applicable.
I don't know. I still don't really know what my Wonderlic was. I'm not gonna lie,
couldn't find it, so then I gave it to you and Craig Way, like during a commercial break back during the sports buffet, and you beat Craig Way. On the one hand.
That's how you know it's a bunch of BS. Because you know that's one of the good ones.
But Deontay Foreman is at the combine. I had a chance to talk to his dad, so I'm sure Derek Foreman's going to listen to this podcast, or maybe he's watching on Facebook Live right now. Deontay's excited, man. He's been down in Pensacola. He and Leonard Fournette have been training together.
Oh, that's good competition. So
talk about a freak.
Yeah.
Freak show.
Yeah.
Yes.
But you know what? He's got the same test that he had to get to Texas, which is basically people question his speed and whether. So he's got to run a good 40. For him, it is all about the 40. He's got to run low 4.5s, high 4.5s.
So we'll see. Catching the ball out of the backfield is going to be huge because he didn't get to do that hardly at all as a senior or as a junior at Texas because of the nature of the offense. And people have questions about his pass blocking, his pass protection ability.
That's ridiculous.
But I talked to Derek, and apparently the word that's gotten back to Deontay from teams is because of the scheme he played in, they're unsure if he can pass protect in a pro style offense.
Okay.
It's more of a technicality than saying he can't pass protect.
That's just a pro conceptual type thing that makes more sense
than he's just not. And and all the issues about ball security were addressed when he said he had played with a broken hand, and all these things
that we're saying that may affect him actually may be the reason why he becomes super value to a team, because when you're talking about not knowing his top end speed, yet he was the type of guy that seemed to be never caught from behind. It's one of those things that a 40 time doesn't always apply to the field time, and he's the type of guy that, you know, if I were to speculate, people that have watched him more and more and more may know him better than, say, a scout just looking at him on paper.
I got the feeling he's going to end up with a good team.
Yeah.
He's got the chance because he's going to drop in the draft. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking. So
great value.
I've heard the Ravens link to Deontay Foreman.
Yeah, you know what I mean? I think
Harbaugh. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. Ooh, that does make sense.
Going from good news to not so good news. And, Tim, you didn't play tight end, but you lined up across from your fair share of tight ends, so this will be in your wheelhouse. Rod, we spent too much damn airtime on this show talking over tight 4 years, man. 4 or 5 years talking about tight ends.
The curse of the tight end.
I'm convinced now it's cursed because
it might be cursed on the
Reese Lato, a young man out of Jinx High School in Oklahoma, who I felt had a chance to be maybe the answer that we've all been waiting for at tight end. His future on the 40 acres is in doubt because he was arrested on Tuesday, according to a report. And arrest records, possession / delivery of a controlled substance with intent to sell within 1,000 feet of a school. Allegedly, reports say had 20 Xanax pills, which he admitted he was intending to sell, and $1,300 in cash on him. Not a good look. Rod, I
didn't know all those details. That's all you can say.
That's a heck of a rap sheet.
Right? It's like, I'm by the school.
When you get busted at high school, that comes with the territory.
I'm in no way making light of the situation when I say this. Not at all, because this is obviously serious. But all I could do was kind of laugh when I had to write a story on this morning and say, if it can go wrong for Texas at the tight end spot, it's going to go wrong. I'm just convinced that's going to happen now, whether it's injuries or missed evaluations or off-field issues. Devonair Clarington doesn't qualify. Something. Anytime you find a guy you think could be the answer, something's going to go wrong. So I'm just going to stop getting my hopes up that Texas is going to find a good tight end.
Well, from the perspective from Texas, though, it is crucial because we were just talking about those two tight ends that they signed were going to play early. And now
I think there's no question Cade Brewer's playing. I still have people saying, he's a redshirt candidate. Like, you don't have that luxury now.
Yeah, you do not have
any depth.
Unless
they just go four wide with all receivers as a base.
But that's not the nature. Well, I don't know. I'm sure you can adapt.
Tom Herman wants to play with the tight end on the surface. He does.
What he calls the pro spread.
Yes. Yeah. They want to play with the tight end because it gives you the ability.
Flexibility.
Yeah.
Multiplicity.
Change your formation variations without changing personnel, personnel out. Mm-hmm. Tim, there's some candidate, Lil Jordan Humphrey's a name that gets brought up quite a bit because he's 6'5", because he's almost 230 pounds, was a high school running back, has played receiver. Mm-hmm. There's something, I mentioned it, I think he could be a guy that if you wanted to manufacture something there, maybe you try him as a kind of that big slot, a flex guy. But Tim, you've been down there in the nitty-gritty at the college level and did it very well. A guy that's never been an inline blocker in his life, that's not an easy transition to make, is it?
No, it's not because, first of all, he's used to blocking Rod and, defensive backs.
Oh, man.
And all of a sudden, he got to go down.
That's a backhanded compliment.
Then he got to come down and block somebody like me or a rag pole.
Right.
He got to change his mental compartment first to just accept
different ball game.
Because I mean, he got to accept it first. If he can accept that he's a tight end and he can get on the field. Because of Jordan Humphrey, I've actually seen him down there at UT. Really good size kids. I thought he played DN when I first saw him.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And he looks bigger than 230 if you ask me now. If he accepted and just get in, just putting the work in the blocking and just getting nasty just to be honest, they're going to abuse him at first. But if you just keep going at it, because we did the same thing to Jermichael Finley when he was making a move.
Right.
But if you just keep working at it, I think that, he should be able to make the swap now. It may not happen in spring ball, but if he get a taste of it in spring ball, then okay, I know I need to work on. By the time fall camp get here, he'd be a lot better.
You played 2 years with Jermichael Finley, Tim. And like you said, he was a high school receiver who had to make that transition. How rough were the rough patches for him?
It was really bad. I mean, you know Derek Lewis. Mm-hmm. Lewis was the he was the GA.
Yeah,
and I remember I'll never forget before practice. He would all D. Lou got that New Orleans accent. J. Mike, come at J. Mike. Hey, we got to get the first bus. the first bus. You got to early.
Get that work. Early work.
Hey, get on the first bus.
Get that early work in.
And he would have his pad, and he just made it a thing that he going to mold Jermichael Finley. He worked with Jermichael Finley because the normal tight end coach, he didn't really have the time. He already had to work with his other guys. Mm-hmm. So they kept working, and I'll never forget, he would say, hey, man, when it come to team period, destroy him every play. Destroy him. make it to the point when he hated. Like, I want him to hate it to the point when he going to respond.
Right.
And that's exactly what we did. We destroyed him every day until all of a sudden he just said, I can't take it no more. You know, he finally, he got it. I mean, he might couldn't hold on to the block, but at least he tried, you know. So that's all that he could do, and he just got better and better at it.
Well, the best tight ends you've gone against him, and that's – Texas wants a guy who's going to project to be an NFL tight end, which means you've got to block in line, you've got to flex, you've got to be an H-back.
Five-tool tight end.
Yeah, the five-tool tight end. I'm going to start calling it the Sasquatch position because I hear about it, I just never see it.
Yeah.
The best you've gone against him, what do those guys have in common? What qualities stick out to you in an elite tight end?
They're big. They're about the size of a DN. Simply, I went against Gronk. I went against Bennett. It was a guy from Kansas City back in the days. He really wasn't a good catcher, but he was a good blocker. Tony Gonzalez was a catcher. I forgot his name, but
Moyaki.
No, it was a he was about 6'6", 6'7", about 280. But jeez. One thing those guys they all have is they got good size. And they look at it as a challenge, like, man, I got embarrassed as defensive end. And they're a gnat. You know a gnat that you know they'd be flying around the fruit at the highs. You've been left out too long.
Yeah.
You know, you keep shooing it away and it just keeps coming back around. He's like, you know, so I thought I killed this thing a long time ago. You know, that was basically what David Thomas was. He didn't have a great size like the other guys, but he was just a gnat. You know, you would chase the ball and think the play is over, and all of a sudden, here come David Thomas out of nowhere, just depletes you. Man. And then run away quickly so you can't get them. You
know? Keep your head on the swivel.
But that's what makes those guys good.
Rod, I've got to think, man, with the tight end position being in a state of flux, because you look at it this spring, I don't know what they're going to do, but we know Andrew Beck's going to miss at least the first week, maybe even more with that broken foot. Peyton Oquinn is the only scholarship tight end they're going to start spring ball with on the roster. I've got to think, and this just got me spitballing, freestyling a little bit, I got to think those running backs now could see a chance where, hey, now I can get my hands dirty in the passing game. If you're a guy like Kirk Johnson, you're a young guy like Tony Carter, maybe now you see, hey, now if I can show I can catch the ball, maybe they could do something with me. Maybe this is my chance to go earn a role.
Yeah, I wonder – I would like to go back and watch some – and I'll have to go watch some of the U of H film from Tom Herman, and even Ohio State, to see how many two-back formations he used, like two-back, three-wide receiver formations, which is something you could do if you have versatility with your backs,
right.
Which he seems to have kind of value that. He had it at Houston. He had that at Ohio State. So maybe – you know, with Chris – I got to go back and look at it. I can't remember off the top of my head, but – you know, that would be an option too. Guys like Chris Warren and some of those other guys. Right. I mean, I people don't do it a ton, but you know, I think just to test it out, maybe in spring, maybe you start looking at some two back formations, put some of those guys in motion, right. And then maybe you can get some of those backs out.
I like the fact that these guys have skill sets to where you can play them together. You can play Chris Warren and Kirk Johnson together. You can play Kirk Johnson and Tuneel Carter together. You can play Kirk Johnson and Daniel Young together. Tuneel Carter and Daniel Young. I mean, Kyle Porter and Chris Warren. You can mix and match with these guys.
Yeah, they're all changing pace. They're all different changes of pace from each other in terms of the skill set and what they can do. And if the running backs and the stats you gave me about the U of H running backs, if they're involved in the passing game, as we think, then he's always looking for creative ways to use them.
Right.
That, because that right now is, you know, something that I think that can be an easy kind of matchup advantage for Texas, especially considering what teams are going to have to do, not getting deep into it, to match up with Texas on the outside, how deep they are at wide receiver, not considering the tight end issue.
Is tight end the biggest issue now on this roster?
On offense? Definitely on offense. Well, you know, I mean, yeah, no question.
On the entire team, would you say?
Oh, interesting. That's a good question.
Well, the way the DBs work.
Yeah, well, looking at each group individually, yeah. I'd say so. Yeah.
If the DBs can bounce back, the DBs
at least have bodies. The tight end position, just the necessity. They don't even have the bodies to work with right now. Yeah. They can't even afford anybody, unfortunately, knocking on wood to get hurt because they don't have the bodies right now. DBs, they performed. Yeah. Bad last year. They were bad. But they got a lot of bodies.
They got a quantity.
Remember they kept throwing out all them different corners? We never knew who the hell was gonna start from week to week. Yeah. It was like, oh no.
It's a work in progress.
But I still think they're talented. Go ahead.
You look at tight end though, that's the type of position like y'all were saying to the offense's success to be maximized, it sounds like it's needed. So whenever you say, okay, if we don't have a tight end, that's gonna hamstring and change the whole offense, which would be that top end ability that if you're having to shift your entire ideology the first year, have some growing pains.
You can use some flex guys, though. Yeah. Flex wide receivers.
Oh, yeah, yeah. If you're looking, like Shipley and stuff, just saying, just a different
from
what. You can
Shipley that thing. You know what I mean? You can Shipley that thing.
If you're looking at some candidates, guys that I think could maybe get a look there to see, like you said, Rod, if you can just kind of wing
thing.
It a
say
little
it,
bit.
Say it, man. We Shipley that thing. That's what you do. Like
just
put
ship
Shipley
it.
In, a Shipley in yeah. the – you know, yeah. I'm going to say something bad. A Shipley in the slot.
There you go.
You know what I mean? So you find
tread lightly, sir.
A ship slot.
So, yeah, it's hard to say that quickly. I'm going to mess that up, but yeah.
I mentioned a little Jordan Humphrey. I think DeMarco Boyd, because you're so deep at linebacker,
ooh,
and he played running
idea.
Back in high school, so maybe – I mean, he's DeMarco Boyd's 5'11", 6 foot, about 235, 240, so maybe he's an H-back type guy. Yeah. You give him a look.
That's the beauty of tight end, too. You usually get a good athlete, and it may take a while, with Michael Finley, but you can develop
it.
They may not have that luxury.
Maybe
now.
A guy like Andrew Fitzgerald at defensive end, if you decide you've got enough depth, if you're going to play more three down. I don't know.
A Caleb Blewett.
I'm just completely freestyling this right now. Just kind
No, that's what they did with Blewett, though. I mean, they moved him. He was a pretty good pass rusher.
Which kind of tied together a conversation we had from last week. Why not go over to the basketball team and be like, Shaq Clair, you are not going to be able to go do anything. Like, go get you a power forward. Get a Jimmy Graham. Like, if you're throwing something against the wall, throw that against the wall.
I don't think there's anybody on the basketball team you could use.
Shaka can't spare it. I love Shaka, but he can't spare it.
I don't think there's
right
anybody
now.
On the basketball team you could go get.
Yep, exactly.
So,
no options.
Times are hard, man. Times are hard. So
yeah, that was a big blow that news about.
We'll see what happens. Yeah. We'll see what happens at tight end though. Tim, want to get your take on
it
something?
Is cursed.
You have been down on the 40 quite a bit, man. Mm-hmm. Oscar Giles said you and Brian Arakpo have been like living over there.
Oh yeah, mm-hmm. I train all the pro guys in there. So,
just your not to give away any trade secrets or anything like that, but just kind of your observations, man. Just kind of getting a look at it and getting to know the coaches and everything. What's your take on where things are headed ahead of spring ball?
Just overall, I can just break it down as far as coaching staff and players. I mean, you can – on the surface, you know, behind the scenes, it can be a lot different than what everyone else see. But behind the scenes, it really seems like the players and the coaches really get along.
Right.
You know, it's not no eggshells or any of that going on. The strength staff, I mean, just talking to some of the players, some of the D linemen, you know, they really, really love Yancey McKnight up there. Like, man, like,
I've got a man crush on Yancey.
You know, they all like, man, you know, a lot of stuff, it just makes sense. You know, he explains everything to us. It just, it's not like, all right, we're going to go run 41,000s. You know, it's just like, why? You know, I play football. I'm not a marathon guy. But it just, used to say, everything makes so much sense and, you know, everything's gelling together and, you know, the staff just more personable. I mean, they see Tom in there with Tom Herman in there. He works out with the guys. You know, he might not be with them, but he'll do his stuff on the side. But, you know, he's getting his workout in. He's just a normal guy. I mean, the first time we came in there, I was like, let's go meet Tom or whatever. And we was like, yeah, we'll just meet him after the workout. And it was like, all right, cool. So we just see in the weight room, we doing our thing. And then all of a sudden we just see Tyron Herman just walked by himself, just like a normal guy. We was like, when the last time you ever seen the Texas head coach by himself?
That's a good
around.
Point.
He's just walking around the facility, just enjoying his thing.
There's no Pat Moore, no Bill Little, or one.
Yeah, none of that. You know, no boosters by him. He's just by himself. Hey, how you guys doing? And he just keep going on his way. He's in another room somewhere. So I guess that's the kind of down to earth that he is, and you know, that's what I've noticed about him. And you know, it's very down to earth. You know, he like to, you know, throw jabs at guys. You know, the competitive side. You know, so they throw jabs right back at him. So it seems like it's a lot. It's just a pretty good environment right now. So.
Tim, I've heard the same thing on the buy-in, that the buy-in, you know, from what I've heard behind the scenes, this staff feels like the buy-in for this team is better than what they got at Houston.
Mm-hmm.
Part of that was they inherited a team in Houston that at least won 8 games and mm-hmm. been to some bowl games. So maybe there was a little bit of pushback. How much of that, and this is what I've heard, is why that is, and I want to get your take on it. I've heard it's just because a lot of these guys, I think I looked at it yesterday, I think you've only got 18 guys that are going to be on this roster in 2017 that have even been to a bowl game.
Yeah.
And I think 10 of those guys were red shirts when they went to a bowl game. I've heard it's just guys are just fed up with losing, man. They're just ready to try something different.
I mean, that's when we talk to them, you know, the good thing now, we always around the guys so we can chat with them. We're starting to get their relationship back going. Yeah. We don't feel funny. You know, you don't feel that you're not comfortable being around. Now we all, hey, man, what's going on? You know, Rakpo, he invited like the whole D-line was hanging out at his house, you know. Yeah. So I'm going to probably take him somewhere too, you know, just to hang out with the guys. Like, hey, man, if you need a place to crash, you can always come over. What's up? You know, just be quiet when you walk in. Don't wake up the kids. You know, but that's how it used to be back in the days. You know, you had a place to go to get away where you knew you were safe. And in the comfort of a former guy, he done been through it too, you know. So it's starting to get back like that. And like you said, guys are just fed up with losing. I mean, you know, 5-7, that's going to make a nasty recipe for everybody involved, yep. You know. So guys are just fed up with losing.
Rod, we talked about this. We love, you and I think, are on the same page. We love the Augie Garrido quote of the world is a different place for a winner than a loser. And I think Tom Herman has hit on, I can't remember from what I was told if he mentioned this in his first meeting or not, but I think the losing having consequences.
Yeah.
I think this team experienced that firsthand when they realized, wow, Charlie really did get fired.
Yeah.
We lost enough games that this man lost his job.
Yeah.
I think it's a hard lesson to learn, man, but sometimes in life, you got to learn a hard lesson to be able to move on and grow and get to where you want to be.
And I think those guys, you know, and they were really loyal to Charlie. You know, they came out to the press conference, all that kind of stuff. And like I said, I do think they loved Charlie. They just didn't really love Texas football as much as they loved Charlie Strong. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, Charlie had that effect. Charlie still does. Everybody talks about how great a recruiter that Charlie is. I think we recognize that too, that Charlie's gone. But I think these guys, above all, they want to win.
Yep.
And I think they realize now the pressure at Texas too, that if you don't win football games, you know, that that life that you were promised as a Texas football player where, you know, everybody loves you and you're constantly praised and you get to walk around and with the burnt orange and everybody adores you, like, you don't get that when you lose. You know what I mean? Like, that light, you don't get that because the world is a different place for winners than it is for losers. Right? You that weight of the burnt orange, you feel it when you're losing. Like, that you feel the weight of that brand. Like, when you're winning, man, that brand uplifts you. But when you're losing, and I didn't lose that much, but we did some. And even the former players, feel the weight of the brand when they're losing. Like, you do. It's like, and it is. It's a weight on the entire Longhorn nation, the community. Yeah. It is. It really is. It's a weight. And that, I think the guys are ready now to lift that weight. I think they know they got to do it. They got to do it as a group. It can't be one or two guys that stand out. Then they got to be led. And Charlie wasn't the right guy. Tom Herman is the right guy. I think they believe that. But the talent is there. That's also because of Charlie, too.
Yeah.
That talent is a ton of talent. They know they're talented. Look, they are, and they know that they are really, really talented. They know they're one of the most talented rosters out there. And Tom Herman knows it too. That's probably why he's kind of cocky right now.
And a situation where the reality sort of sets in, because it's not as if you would say, it isn't like you are entitled, but whenever you realize that the repercussions of your actions really are dependent upon your success, and it's sort of a confidence thing that, like, yeah, you had been really good your whole life, but now you hit something and it hit that wall, and it's just being able to have that reality that, okay, it's sort of a reset of the bearings that you can have. People have it in all sorts of levels of work that they feel as if maybe lacking some confidence or finding something that works really well for you. And it's all sometimes just needing, like you say, a new group of people, a new fresh start to start
fresh
at a new baseline to go there. And then it isn't as if you were entitled, but it's a reality that there can be entitlement. You don't just get this when it comes with it. You really do then have to work as hard as you did to get to that point.
It really is, like Jeff said. That's why I love football. I love sports because it teaches you so many life lessons. That, you know, talent ain't enough. This is a talented group. And they're like, man, we're out here getting our butts kicked. Yeah.
Exactly.
I thought we were really talented.
Yeah.
Like, no, talent ain't enough.
Trying your best ain't enough sometimes.
Love ain't enough sometimes. We love Charlie Strong. Well, sorry. Love ain't enough. It ain't enough sometimes.
You think all those other guys don't love their coaches?
Oh, you loved it. Oh, so well. You didn't take care of it. You didn't cherish it. You didn't do all the things you were supposed to do to keep that love and to make sure that love kept its damn job.
Yeah,
you didn't do that. So now you learn. That's where repercussions. So they're learning all these things. They're still a young team. They can't be young forever, but I think they learned all that, their lessons of being a young group.
Tim, you mentioned something that I thought was interesting, that guys, when they're around Yancey McKnight, that he doesn't mind answering the why. Mm-hmm. Why are we doing this? Why? You know, and he mentioned that we got to meet with him a couple of weeks ago, and he said that's one thing that he actually likes about this generation. He said it's not like back when he played and you did it just because it's what you're told to do. Even like, you know, Rod, back when you guys were on the 40. Did it. Mad Dog tells you to do something. You just do it.
Put the weight vest on. Get over there and run a 1,000-yard shuttle. Let's go.
That's a generational thing that it isn't as if why is challenging it. It's just, well, why? I'd like to know.
But
it helps.
Junction boys kind of stuff.
Tim, do you notice this generation and the kids you train? Because you train high school kids, you get the kids that Texas is getting, and they've got that kind of same generation. Do you find that this generation is more intrigued by the why? And do you, as a strength coach, have to be more adaptable to answer the why rather than, well, it's just because I said so, because I'm the coach and you're the player, you just do it?
Well, the high school kids are different. You know, they still are. You know, if I say, yeah, don't tell me about the why, I'm just going to do it, they'll do it. But I always educate those guys. Anybody I train, I try to educate you too, you know. So, because if I drop over and die, you can still work out and do it correctly. So I don't want to get anybody
injured.
That's
a pretty morbid way to put it, Tim, but okay.
You know, I don't want to get anybody injured, you know. So that's why I think me and Yancey, as far as when we talk, you know, we both, you know, just talking methods and stuff. And, you know, me and his methods are different, but, you know, still the same. We like to work hard and you know, we like to tell the guys, and we love why recovery is so important and all this. And, you know, but you're right, man. I mean, a lot of the guys, they want to know the why. You know, they may not tell you they want to know the why, but you get more respect if you tell them why we're doing this.
Yancey seems really big on the recovery aspect of it. Like, I know he's talked about, breathing exercises and different stretching and stuff.
They do a lot of stuff like that.
Never heard of that part of it. I mean, I think of recovery, I'm like, well, just go sit in the tub for about five minutes and you'll be, grab your protein shake and stretch a little bit, you'll be good. But it's not as deeper than that.
Just before every workout, just watching some of those, you know, before every workout. Like I said, a lot of the stuff is similar that we do as far as recovery stuff. But I know that before the workout, the guys got to be in there at least 20 minutes before the workout starts. You know, they got this, you know, rollout station where they got these thick, you know, PVC pipes, and because a lot of times it used to be the foam roll, and there's more, you know, intense PVC pipes and, you know, softballs and baseballs to dig into that deep tissue to, you know, relieve some of that scar tissue. And this is all before the workout, you know. So they do, and the guys are starting to buy in because before when we first got there, we didn't see as many guys. But now we're starting to see a lot more guys coming in and, you know, rolling out early. Because that's how it is in pros. You know, professionals are like that. We get there early, roll out. You get to practice early, you know, get your little individual in, then practice start, you know, so.
And if you feel good after doing it, I mean, getting some type of good performance that your body reacts to may just help them want to come back too.
Yeah, exactly.
You mentioned something, Tim, when you and I first started talking about your training methods and kind of how you build your program. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I remember you talking a lot about core strength. Guys don't understand the importance of core strength. And I know Yancey's really big on, if you've got an injury, 9 times out of 10, it relates to having a weak core. Yeah. Your core's got to be strong. It seems like he's really – the core and the lower body is really – because he's admitted he's not a big press guy. He's not a big bench press or big military press guy. He really hammers core strength and flexibility in your legs. You got to hammer the lower body.
Yeah, I mean – It's three things when you break down a lot of sports injury, no matter sport, maybe really football players. It's three things. And again, I'm teaching the pro guys this now because you'd be surprised a lot of guys don't know that. One of the reasons a lot of guys get hurt, the main reason is a lack of symmetry. You know, you're more strong in the chest than the back. Mm-hmm. You know, you're really strong in the glutes, but not the hip flexors or the quads, you know, something like, or hamstrings, you know, so. And another issue is the core strength. And then the last one, which is a lot of guys forget about it, is flexibility. You know, guys do not want to stretch. You know, I tell the guys all the time, I'm like a cheetah. You know, I don't have to warm up. I can get out there right now. If I want to put some cleats on and go run a 40-yard dash, let me get a couple high knees and jumping jacks and let's go. You know, because I stretch all the time. But, you know, I could tell that he's really big on that stuff. And it's helping the guys because a lot of guys, I mean, they have some. If you walk in the weight room, it looks like a body, like a Gold's Gym in there. I mean, just bodybuilders galore. But a lot of the guys are, you know, they so stiff. So yeah. He's trying to get those guys to loosen it up, you know, open it up, and let's start moving more like a football player. We still gonna lift heavy on certain days, but let's start moving like football players.
That's one of the things you notice, especially, you know, covering recruiting, and guys get caught up in, wow, man, he's, you know, he weighs this much and he's this big, and you can look at a guy's body and I'm gonna say, he's a you know, like a pectoral tear waiting to happen because he's just wound so tight.
And that's where flexibility is so big because, I mean, if you aren't flexible, that's where you get a lot of the detaching of muscles to tendons or tendons to bones, which can be a lot of those injuries that just happen one quick burst and boom, you're out for six, 8 weeks or something.
Yeah, you're right.
Tim, I don't want to minimize strength conditioning, but it sounds like when you start breaking it down, and we talked a lot over the years about it, it doesn't seem like there's a quote-unquote right way to do it, but there's a lot of wrong ways to do it.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, the biggest thing as far as strength and conditioning is the art of the workout. That's where I see a lot of the programs at the lower levels. You know, they may be doing great exercise. I mean, nobody's invented the wheel. I mean, they was doing pull-ups in biblical times, probably. Right. You know, push-ups. You know, so nobody invented that. But
Caesar getting some crunches.
But if you do it every single day, something's going to break down at some point. It's like a steak. If you keep cooking, it's going to burn it. And that muscle, I mean, it's going to get tighter and tighter, and you're going to have your hard steak, and it's going to be like beef jerky after a while when you know, if you don't hydrate it and all that. So, you know, that's the difference. So it's just more just the art of the workout that's more important than anything.
So we got about, gentlemen, we got about, I don't know, 25, 30 minutes left in this show. I want to talk spring football. And by the way, we mentioned Mark Henry a little bit ago at the start where I did insult Mark unintentionally, saying Tim is my favorite guest.
Mm-hmm.
Can Tim and Mark be 1A and 1B?
I'm just saying, Mark is.
And then I'll have Casey Stutter mad at me. Well, Earl Thomas mad at me. Lamar Houston mad at me.
Yeah. No, I'm not worried about them. I'm worried about Mark.
Yeah, that's the one to be most worried about.
That's the world's strongest man. The rest of them I'll deal with.
I'll put Stutter too.
Do you know where Mark Henry is today?
It's probably at UT. I just saw him up there.
He's on the 40. He's on the 40. watching some workouts.
Yeah, I just saw him up there. Actually, we were just talking for a while. Yeah.
It sounds like UT in the offseason is like one of those workout camps. Like they got Mark Henry in one corner or Rakpo in the other, just hanging out.
And, you know, speaking of Yancey, McKnight, Mark's name got brought up when we were talking to him. And he said, hey, the guy was a freaking Olympic weightlifter. If he wants to come in and teach these guys something about what's going on, by all means. It's interesting, though, right? Yeah. And I want to get Mark back
and
in here. Because
he's Mark Henry. Who's going to tell Mark Henry no? Right. Nobody tells Mark Henry no when he walks in. Mark Henry, he's like, hey, what do you want
to
do?
That's how it is when he shows up to this radio station. And he just walks down the hall.
Mark's even said he's changed his workouts over there. Like he said he doesn't lift real heavy anymore, and he's into more, you know,
like
core strength.
This was my first time seeing Mark in a long time, like probably over a year or more. And Mark, I was telling another guy, they was like, man, Mark is huge. You know, Mark Henry. I told him, I said, man, he's way smaller than what he used to be.
Oh, yeah.
He's way smaller than what he used to be.
Yeah, he lost a lot of weight.
Yeah.
He leaned down. It's just straight muscle. I mean, last time I saw him, it was so compact that he's one of those guys that still his shoulders and traps are wider than his waist.
Yeah.
And he's 400 pounds.
He really is made to do Hollywood movies. So I think whenever he gets done, going to start getting into like some of the comic book movies or something. should be like a villain.
Yes, he should be, what's that thing, the juggernaut or the thing?
Well,
like one of those,
like, I'm just waiting on him to get one of those roles. He's perfect for it.
Like Bane?
Whatever is. I mean, he just make one for me. He's making it's easy.
I don't know if Bane can bend a frying pan with his bare hands, but I've seen Mark Henry do it. So,
dude, I've
boom,
seen this dude
there you go.
Pull like a semi-trailer.
It's
like
amazing.
It's on YouTube.
Yeah, that dude is unbelievable. Grown man strength.
He can probably show up to those World's Strongest Man competitions and beat them all.
So, Mark, we'll have Mark here in studio soon enough, back on the show soon enough. Guys, I want to talk spring ball in the time we've got left. Spring practice starts next week, man, next Tuesday.
Nice.
Next Tuesday,
I like
the Longhorns get rolling. I had a story up on the site, horns247.com, basically looking at three objectives Texas needs to get done this spring, and I kind of want to kind of go around the room and get y'all's take on these three objectives. Rod, this first one can cover a lot of ground, and it's one we've talked about. Established a clear, defined identity on both sides of the football. When people ask Tom Herman, how would you describe this offense? Or you ask Todd Orlando, how would you describe this defense? It'd be nice to not just hear, well, we're multiple. Okay, that's great. What does that mean? How would you describe yourself?
Yeah.
If you can get to the end of spring ball and they can say, this is what we do well. We looked at our talent. This is what we think we do well. And offensively, This is within the framework of our offense. This is what we think we can do really well that can define us. You look at this decade of Texas football, the 46 and 42 cumulative record, 16 and 21 over the last 3 years. There's been too many seasons where we really haven't been able to define what this team is on one side of the ball or the other.
Yeah, offensively, we've had an identity crisis for a long time, right? I mean, that's just even just looking at the coordinators. Well, we've had 8, 9 coordinators in the last 7 years.
I think Tim Beck is the seventh in 7 years.
Yeah, I mean, play caller, but in terms of co-offensive coordinator, we've had a ton of different minds calling the shots up there.
It should be pre-Greg Davis, post-GD.
Exactly. So, I agree with you. I think you got to figure out what you do well. And I would say last year, they started to figure out what they did well, and that was basically Deontay Foreman. He's no longer here. So figure out what you do well, and that's your identity. Mm-hmm. What you do as well, if not better than anybody else, that's your identity. On offense, for Tom Herman, I don't know really what that's going to be. It depends on what Chris Warren does and what kind of identity he has. But I will say on defense, That D line, that front seven, to me, I think is going to be kind of the identity. I think they're gonna roll the dice and take a lot of chances. They're going to be one of those defenses.
Like we talked about.
Very aggressive. Yeah.
Like we talked about last week, the quote of Todd Orlando's availability that stuck with me, and it's going to be the one I hang on until September 2nd against Maryland. And I'm going to paraphrase it here. He said, I don't want to be you can defend the whole field and bleed it out 80 yards, but I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
And we talked about, Charlie Strong and Vance Bedford that first year they were here. That was kind of the mentality, and it worked. I mean, when you've got NFL guys at every level of that defense,
which they did.
Eventually you'll find a way to stop somebody. When you have, not to say guys are less talented, but when you're lacking experience or you're lacking leadership or you're lacking some kind of linchpin that makes your defense, at some point you're going to give up an explosive play in that quest to make them go 10, 12, whatever, how many plays.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Tim, any thoughts on kind of the identity you'd like to see from, based on kind of what you've seen, what you know about Tom Herman, knowing the personnel, kind of identity you think this team can form or start to form this spring?
Just start defensively, no matter, because, I mean, to be honest with you, they may not just know what they got yet. I mean, they just got here, so they haven't really even saw the guys play football. They've just been seeing weightlifting and running wind sprints, but football is way more than that, but if they do a couple of things as far as defensively, it don't really matter what scheme they run, 4-2-5, 3-4. If you see those guys run to the football, hit whoever got the football, and party like rock stars, I don't care what defense you run, it's going to work. So if they do those three things, they'll be fine offensively. Don't be conservative. Keep your foot on the gas and just use your athletes. I've been training to Jay Johnson in the morning, and it's like, man, I shed a tear for him every time I see him. Like, man, I'm just looking at this guy just in amazement. My jaw is on the ground every time I train him. Like what happened?
Part of that offensive identity crisis. He's one of those guys that got swept up in it.
Why didn't they put you at running back? Yeah. Why didn't they put you at receiver, slot? I mean, they got you at the kickoff return, but, man, I think you may be a better running back than receiver. Yeah.
Other than what they did with him.
Yes. Just hand him the ball.
Just give. It's like I always tell you, it's like playground football. Whoever's the most talented kid, get the ball to his hand, no matter how many times it takes. I don't care who it pisses off. They need to pick their game up and let it be. We're going to win. Yeah. Or use him as a decoy.
Yeah, I look at a guy, we've talked about him, with Devin Duvernay last year. He gets one target in the K-State game, and the one target is an 80-yard touchdown, and you don't hear from him again. It's like, clearly, that guy, when he gets the ball in his hands, does something special with it. That guy needs to touch it.
That's part of the identity crisis, though, right? Marquise Goodwin, we dealt with that. DJ Monroe, we dealt with that, right? Yeah. The list goes on and on. There have been guys like, that dude is electric. Get that guy the football. But, because the offense, they don't know who they are offensively, they cannot use those guys within
the system. And then players really never can advance within the system because they never get given the shot, considering you have a new guy each time.
And also, some guys got themselves in trouble too.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, you're right.
That slot position, though, we talk about Devin Duvernay, thinking about Jerod Hurd, you look at Armani Foreman, that slot position is going to be interesting to watch how that thing develops, because that guy, he's going to have to be a running back on some plays. He's going to have to be a bubble screen, a jet sweep guy. He's going to have to be a guy who can stretch the field vertically. I think your passing game is going to revolve, if I can talk right today, largely around who's in that slot position and what do you get out of it?
But you're so deep at wide receiver. Sure. I mean, yeah, you got to worry about four guys that can play that position.
I think everything, Rod, I think if you look at what Tom Herman did at Houston, mm-hmm. whether it was DeMarcus Ayers or Linnell Bonner, I think everything is going to play off of that slot.
No,
And that's the thing offensively. And in watching some of Tom Herman's stuff, Rod, you can tell me if I'm wrong. I think we've talked a little bit about this, but it kind of reminds me of Brian Harsin's offense a little bit. Yeah, just in terms of
the motor,
personnel, but I can do same personnel and I can run a counter, but I'm going to run the counter out of 10 different formations with the same personnel.
He uses a lot of shifts and motions too.
The difference is, Tim, like you said, I think Tom Herman's more of a guy that's going to keep his foot on the gas more than Brian Harsin, who at times was too calculated and too kind of, okay, I got to pick my spot and I'm going to pick my spot and I'm going to just belabor the point. I mean, in other words, if you're running a counter or a zone, whatever you're doing, the base plays in your offense, it should all be to set up something.
Yeah, you're right.
What is the counter off this? Okay, when they start overcommitting to the counter, boom, I hit them with this. Mm-hmm. And then when they start playing that, boom, I can hit them with this. I don't think we've seen a lot of that from Texas the last few years. And I think the personnel at times has been there to where you could take more advantage of that. So I think just maximizing your personnel and maximizing your chances to score. Because, man, in this league, the 1-3 and out you have during a game could be the difference between a win and a loss.
Yeah, you got to be able to score points. And that's why I think they're going to go more vertical too, right? I think doesn't Tom Herman have more vertical passing game within his offense?
He got the guys to do it. I mean,
he's got a lot of
Colin
guys that can go. Yeah.
He's legit 6'6".
Yeah.
He got me by a couple of inches. The other kid, Bird, I think he's going to come back.
Oh, man,
John
Bird.
Yeah, we forget about
that's a great vertical weapon to have just
that's
there.
Crazy.
I think he's going to make a bounce back, man. And,
man, world-class speed. Forget about John Bird.
Oh, yeah, and they got a lot of world-class speed. I mean, Duvernay, I mean, he looks like a running back if you look at him.
Yeah, he sounds like that piece that Jeff was explaining.
Perfect
that you slide. Exactly, you know, and so, then – sorry, go ahead.
But, I mean, those guys are – they got so many receivers. Like, what to do with them?
Yeah. I think I agree with you. So I think they should start off kind of throwing it deep so teams kind of have to come into the game adjusting for that. They do that. Chris Warren in the backfield, I think, can eat teams alive.
And then on top of what Jeff was saying with the type of offense and what you were explaining, just always having that base package to be building basically a misdirection or a secondary play off of it, it reminded me when you were explaining that exactly what I saw from the Atlanta Falcons offense with Shanahan with your good friend Rod. And then I thought back, I was like, well, that makes sense whenever back in the day. Do you know if Shanahan and Herman ever kept in touch, any type of football ideology type guys, considering they both been deep in the coaching realm and it sounds quite
that's
similar?
That's a good question. I don't know, but that could easily be the case.
Because what
Shanahan
Jeff explained
name
was that.
With, coaching, that could easily have happened. I don't know that. So that's a good point. Could happen, considering the roots and considering
the roots
how,
are very similar.
And considering, both of them have been big-name coordinators and big names.
In Red Texas originally.
Yeah. And
together.
Yeah. If it hasn't happened, it's probably going to happen pretty soon.
Exactly. Oh, so that's even better.
Yeah.
Tim, I want to talk defense with you for a little bit, and we've spent the last couple podcasts, Rod and I have just kind of chopping it up about the defense because it was so bad last year, unexpectedly bad.
Everybody was bad in the Big 12 too, though. Everybody said West Virginia and K-State, basically.
Right.
Right?
It's like saying,
I know.
It's like telling my wife, you got bleach all over my clothes. Yeah, my clothes are ruined too. But
I agree. I know. It's not good. I'm just throwing it out there for perspective.
Tim, when you watch, and I'm not even talking about schematically, and maybe it's some of the stuff you talked about, like running to the football having a mentality. What did you see as the big issue the last 2 years, and specifically last year, that you can pinpoint that the defense was bad because of?
Communication.
Good question.
Yeah,
communication. Nice. That's the first thing I thought of. Communication. I mean, if you got DBs in the back pointing, just like you were supposed to get this guy, he was supposed to get that guy. That's communication. So what as a coach, if you see something like that, you got to dummy down your system because that means it's more than one person. My thing is, if one guy's not getting it, we got to get him off the field. But if your whole back end and your linebackers and your D line are all off track, you got to dummy down your system. I mean, I was talking to Roger McElroy. He was like, when Muschamp came in, he was throwing all his NFL stuff. We had to learn everything. Then, we started out good, and all of a sudden we had a bad game. Then, You know, he scrapped like four packages. He's like, hey, we got to dumb this thing down, and this is what we're going to live and die by. We're going to force them to do one thing. If they beat us on that, hey, they just had a great day.
Yeah.
But they're not going to run on us, you know, so we're going to make them pay. But that's what I think that's really the thing is that, you know, they just didn't communicate. You could definitely see that it was a schematic thing. Again, as a D lineman, and I was talking to, you know, my coach, Coach Giles, you know, about the 3-4, and I was just like, yeah, coach. You know, if I was here, you guys said we're going to run a 3-4. You're going to put me inside as a 4-hour something. I would have shook your head and said, it's time for me to transfer. Because he was like, yeah, I know you would have did it too. I said, but, you know, as a D lineman, I mean, that's like a death sentence. You say, hey, go play a 4-hour, yeah. A head up nose, because you know what it is. You're going to have to get double teamed every play.
AJW right there, man.
You know, it's for the linebackers. And my thing was, as a player, I was – which makes you good. I was selfish and I was greedy.
You get no glory at that position.
You know, and my thing is if I'm holding up two guys and the linebacker is not going to make a play, and then when I watch that film the next day, I'm about to raise hell on everybody in the film room. You know, so that's just the way I was when I was there, you know. So, but yeah, that's what it is, communication. That's definitely what it is, communication. And they just got to dumb it down. I mean, just, you know, this is who we got. You know, let that guy stay there and let him go to work. You know, don't be trying to move him around here and there, and that might just confuse the guy, you know, so just let him be.
That's kind of one of the things I wrote in here about the defense. Just there were times, and I thought Malik Jefferson's comments after the Oklahoma State game were telling, where he's like, guys just aren't confident in what they're doing. And just find something, even if you can only do one or within your scheme, and if there's only one or two things that you figure out, okay, we do this really well. Man, hone in on that and drill it in and make sure they believe in it. Give them something to sink their teeth into. Let them get confident in that and then kind of go on to the next one and just build it instead of just – I've never – you guys have played at the highest level, and maybe you guys can tell me I'm an idiot or whatever. I've never understood the coaching mentality of coaches that just, here's the playbook, go learn it.
Yeah.
Like, why? Like, figure out what your guys can do.
It's just, well, it's just like you were talking about, Tim, about the workouts, right? Yeah. Tell me why I'm doing it.
Yeah.
That's what Coach Keenan was good at. Like, tell me why I'm doing it. Tell me why that now we are going to, you know, change to cover three when they are in trips to this side of the field. Like, you know, explain it
process
to me. Don't just give it to me. And so I think that's what it's more about. And that's the communication you were talking about.
Oh, yeah.
Charlie basically, I think, did exactly that. Remember the wristbands that the guys started wearing because they couldn't figure out what to check to and when to check? The up-tempo offenses obviously are a big part of that, and that's part of Big 12 culture. So that just hurts communication by the definition. But, no, you're totally right. So I remember Charlie doing that, and I was like, well, that's to help the guys with communication. And that was to simplify it, too. Basically, they started running, like, three coverages. Remember Charlie said that? We ran, like, three or four coverages toward the end of the year. So they
I just wish it would have been before the sixth game of the year.
I understand all that. But I'm just trying to add to you guys' point.
No, yeah.
That exactly was the issue, that all of those things you brought up. And the one thing this defense does well is they do rush the passer. They did that really well. I think they led the Big 12 in sacks.
11th or better nationally in sacks every year under Charlie Strong.
Yeah.
I think fifth the last 2 years.
That's a good thing. That's a good thing to be good at.
Yeah. Exactly. And it just, talking about that communication or the wristband simpling in down, that's sort of what we've seen, a common trend in modern sports. I mean, you see it with offense, just with symbols bringing in plays instead of long cadences, different things like that. And then when you told that story of McElroy, though, and him coming in at halftime and saying to scrap half the playbook, I think we have audio of that, actually, because he immediately just told them one thing to do.
Everybody just do your job!
I think that was exactly it. He came in and scrapped 14 defenses and then just said, it's gap control. Everybody do your job. That's all you got to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Oh, that's awesome.
Love me some Will Muschamp.
I am happy Muschamp's a part of Longhorn lore. That's
I remember watching him on TV. I was like, man, I would love to play for that guy.
I think everybody said that. Yeah.
I'm looking at a rag pole getting all those sacks, and it's like they're just getting a go call every time. I'm like, man, he don't have to worry about the run at all. He just get to rush every play and let everybody else take care of everything.
It seems like that.
That's great.
I'm going to be me, and I'm going to be Will Muschamp.
You got Earl Thomas in the back end.
Yeah.
You can do that.
You're right.
You can do that.
It opens up a lot.
It's
sort of like your DBs with Casey Hampton and Sean Rogers in the middle. It opens up the back.
Boom. Thank you very much. Yeah.
The only other things I've got, guys, on this, just to kind of close us out this week, the two objectives, and I'll let you guys, speak on this. don't let up on stressing the importance of winning. It's cool now that you've got the competitions and one group gets Gatorade and steak and potatoes and everything they want. The other group gets basically like bread and water lose, which, I mean, that's what I've heard. Basically, like,
that's life.
Like, it's like a steak buffet and these omelets and everything. And the other group's like some yogurt, bread and water over here.
I like
over
it,
here
man.
Outside of Moncrief.
Winners, baby. I like it.
Don't give up. I mean, make it a, you know, if offense doesn't score in a goal line period, the whole offense does up downs for half the period or whatever. Yep. I mean, just make it a competition. Mm-hmm. Just understand. I mean, this team, guys, and this is one of the things that, again, another thing that I'll hit on from now until September 2nd, these guys don't really know how to win. Mm-hmm. You know, they're talented. They, again, they know on any given Saturday, if they put it all together, they're capable of playing with anybody in the country. They don't know how to consistently do that each and every week, and the grind it takes to do that each and every week. So the more Tom Herman can teach them lessons that winning is the best thing you could do and losing is just not acceptable, you should never get comfortable losing, man, I'm all for it. And I think the fan base should be all for it. I mean, you don't want, like, nobody beating on players or whatever, but I mean, hey, if defense gives up four touchdowns on a, you know, a four play goal line period and you've got to do up downs after the period, then, you know, so be it.
Psychologically, these young guys have been through a lot about that lately too. So I agree with you. Psychologically, that's what Tom Herman's about, and it comes from like that Urban Meyer tree. That Urban Meyer tree.
The other thing that I had was know who your leaders are and give them a chance to step up and lead.
Who are the leaders?
That's the thing. I think you got to identify those guys.
Well, yeah, I don't know if you can identify them just yet. I don't know if they've paid the price yet. Remember, they have to earn their horns and all that yet. This is a part of it, though. The offseason, as you know, Tim, that's that Lord of the Flies time where ain't no coaches around, just the strength guys. And the team leaders, they're really kind of determined in the offseason during that time.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. I mean, figure out who those guys are. You'll see those guys emerge at some point. Give them a chance to step up and lead. You know, if they make them, you know, maybe you got to pull, you see somebody's lead, maybe you got to pull them aside and say, hey, it's okay if you chew that guy out for taking a rep off. It's okay if you do that. I'm cool. We're on the same page, man.
Accountability.
Because no matter how Tom Herman's taking on the role that I felt, we talk about this a lot, the role I felt Charlie Strong should have taken on, especially that second year when you lost all those guys to the NFL, I felt like he had to step up and be the leader. You know, if there's a leadership void, somebody's got to step up and show guys how to lead. I think Tom Herman's doing a really good job of that right now. And this staff, Yancey McKnight and those assistants.
Like you said,
they're setting the tone.
They don't know how to win, and they don't have any leaders. That's Tom Herman's role right now. That's why you see him, like you said, Tim, walking around. It's like, why is he just walking around? Hey, man, he's checking it out. Where are my leaders at?
Yeah, but I think by the end of spring ball, though, I think you'll feel, you know, hopefully by halfway, you'll figure out who those guys are and kind of let them take the baton a little bit.
What a great opportunity. I would love to go to Texas when there'd be no leaders. If I was a player, I'd be like, I'm about to take this thing over. This is about to be my team. Right. I would Donald Trump that damn team. I would take it over. No leadership. This is my team. Boom.
Clean slate cuts both ways, man.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that was a compliment, people. Don't get mad about it. That wasn't political.
It's a new day for everybody. Matt, thanks for producing it this week, sir.
You are more than welcome.
Rob B., appreciate the time and the knowledge.
Anytime, brother.
Tim, good to see you again, my friend.
Appreciate you bringing me back.
Best
man.
Of luck with the training, and we'll sit down, have lunch, chop it up soon.
Oh, yeah.
One of those days. I want to go to that lunch.
Hey, you can come too, Rod. Rod, I invite you, man. You never go anywhere.
That's true, too.
Yeah.
He goes to work in Mexico.
For Matt, for Rod, for Tim, for Travis, who videoed it. For everybody at AM 1300 The Zone, AM1300TheZone.com, where you can hear this podcast each and every week. And thanks to Matt, you get us on iTunes, TuneIn, SoundCloud, and any podcast app.
Yep, just type in Longhorn Blitz.
For the Zone family, for the Horns 24/7 family, I'm Jeff Howe. Thank you so much for downloading and listening, and we will catch you again on the next episode.
You've been listening to Longhorn Blitz with Horns247.com. Remember, for the latest Longhorn news 24/7, visit Horns247.com.